we get information from them, a copy of their green card, they sign a statement, we submit to the SBA, and then they come back and basically confirm that the individual that's applied for the loan is here lawfully. Historic approval is something that comes up occasionally, more so in Cincinnati. Because it's a government loan program, SBA is very concerned about doing projects for properties that are either on or have the potential to be on the National Register of Historic Places. And there's obviously a list of businesses, of buildings that are on the National Register. But where we can kind of get caught up sometimes is that in Cincinnati, there are a number of National Register districts, over the Rhine being the most prominent one, where any building that would be in a historic district has to go through this process, whether they're on the National Register or not. Over the Rhine is 300 acres and has hundreds of properties. And if somebody comes in and does a project at Over the Rhine, we have to go through a pre-clearance process through the Ohio State Preservation Board to make sure what they're doing to the building would not have an adverse effect to the historic nature of the property. And that generally involves getting plans and specs and submitting information to the Ohio State Preservation Board of Columbus to get a clearance that the project would not have an adverse effect on this property and federal funds that therefore can be used for the project. So if you're you think you potentially could be in a historic district, or you are in a historic district, that's something that needs to be done up front, because unfortunately the State Preservation Board gives themselves 45 days to answer a question on whether there's an eligible property project or not, and sometimes they take more time than that. So this is something that needs to be done up front and started early. Now, as far as submitting project costs, we need a valid purchase contract on the property. It has to be at the same address as the as what the appraisal has. If there are any renovations or reconstructions, we need contractor estimates. Every once in a while, we'll have somebody come in and go, well, I'm a contractor, and I want to build a building for myself. SBA would allow that, but before they would allow that, they would want that contractor go out and get two other estimates from other contractors in order to make sure that the bid that this individual is bringing in is less than what the bids would be from another contractor. They don't want somebody doing their own work and paying themselves a premium to do it. So they have to verify that their cost estimates are reasonable and under the market. And then we can also include professional fees, title insurance, appraisal, environmentals, surveys. It's good to get estimates for all those costs if we're going to include them in the project. So we have a pretty good number. If the appraisal is $1,500 and the phase one is $1,000 and the survey is going to be $750, then we're not guessing what that is, so we have to go back and change our use of funds later on. If it turns out we just kind of pulled a number out of the air, we'd like not to do that. All real estate projects with SBA have to have an environmental report, and depending on what it is, depends on what we have to get. Now, your bank may have its own policies on environmental, but if you're doing a 504 loan, it's what the SBA wants is what's going to rule. So starting out, if it's a small project and we don't think there's an environmental problem and the 504 debenture is under $150,000, we can just get an environmental questionnaire signed by the seller that basically would say there's no knowledge of environmental problems on the property. You know, I'm taking I'm buying what used to be a residential property, and it's surrounded by other residences, and it's, you know, there's probably no environmental issue for this property. And if it's under $150,000, we can just go with the questionnaire. If it looks like it's a clean property though, and it's over $150,000 debenture, we can still do a questionnaire, but we have to get a record search and risk assessment. And those generally cost about $350 to $500, where we send the address into an environmental company, they do a record search, and based upon their looking at the environmental records of the area, come back to whether they consider it to be a low risk or a high risk. If it's a low risk, then we're able to use the questionnaire and the RSRA and submit that to SBA, and that's generally acceptable to cover our environmental requirement. If we start out with a questionnaire and the RSRA and it comes back as a high risk, then we have to do a phase one. Now, some properties, and it's listed in your book, and there's a number of them, automatically require a phase one. You can't do a questionnaire and RSRA if it's a gas station or if it's another property that's listed in your book. So SBA has a list of these environmentally sensitive properties, automatically have to start with a phase one. Now, phase ones are generally ordered by the third-party lender. We don't necessarily get involved in the ordering of phase one. The only condition, if your institution orders the phase one, or if you allow the applicant to order it, the SBA requires that the environmental firm sign what's called a reliance letter. Can't come up with it. And so there is a standard SBA letter that cannot be modified that the environmental firm must fill out and submit as part of the attachment to the phase one when this is being submitted to the SBA. In addition, the environmental company must have at least $1 million of liability coverage, and they have to submit a binder that they have environmental coverage as well. So when we're doing that, sending to the SBA, it's going to be the reliance letter signed by the environmental company, the phase one, and a copy of the insurance binder from the environmental company showing that they have insurance, that if something is wrong on the company and we need to go after somebody, their insurance company covers it. Now, in certain cases, when we're doing the phase one, there may be, it doesn't come back clean, it comes back further testing is necessary. And that would be a phase two. And that's where basically we may be going out and doing soil testing or something else. And that, again, would be done with a reliance letter where that phase two would then be submitted to the SBA and they can rely on that. Hopefully, the phase two would come back and say, we thought there was something in the property. Phase one said that we thought there was something in the property. We did the testing, it's clean, we're good to go, and that's generally enough for the SBA to move forward. Gas stations are a special category where they automatically have to start with the phase one, especially a lot of the newer gas stations because of the environmental rules and regulations and equipment for the last couple of years. Generally, they're pretty good. That's when we get back to a station that's maybe been in the same location for 50 years, that we probably pretty much know we're going to have to do a phase two. And there are certain requirements that the environmental company has to follow when doing a phase two for the insurance company and some other testing that has to take place. So if you have a gas station business, get in touch with us and we can let you know what those additional requirements are. All our applications have to have a bank commitment letter because if we don't have a commitment from a third-party lender, we don't have a deal. Generally, the letter can be basically whatever you normally do, as long as it spells out the financing and the term and the rate, and if you have an adjustable interest rate that you give us what the index is when you adjust it to. And then generally, the SBA would require either in your letter or a separate document that we can give you basically the language that why the SBA is needed. So that's something we can take care of with you. We need to see organizational docs and tax ID numbers for our borrowing entities. So if we have an EPC, we have an operating company, they need to be set up with their state. It doesn't necessarily have to be the state that the property's in. We obviously see sometimes a Kentucky business doing a building in Ohio, and then they have to be registered in Ohio as a foreign corporation. But we need the organizational documents. If we're doing a refinance project, we have refinance documents that we need, copies of notes and transcripts that we need to submit to the SBA to show that the refinance is eligible. And then there's some HCDC forms that we would have as part of our application.
What bank do you normally
use in that area? We use all of them. There's no restriction on the lender we use. Probably in any one year, we might be looking at doing loans with 20 different lenders. But again, it could be an individual, it could be a government. For the most part, it's going to be GE Credit Union, or it's going to be Fifth Third Bank,
okay.
Or
FCA. It'll have to be SBA approved.
Yeah, because the bank is really not making the loan to the SBA. The bank is doing this with us. Their involvement with the SBA is kind of minimal. The bank loan is part of our deal. They have things they have to do as part of the application, but there's no further reporting requirements or anything else that the bank has to do to the SBA. So it's a way for a bank that normally doesn't do SBA financing to do SBA financing, because there isn't a lot of SBA requirements down the road, unlike the 7A program, which has a bunch. Yes?
Just out of curiosity, golf courses, environmental sensitive, is that just fertilization?
Or? It must be. It must be because of all the fertilization they use. So again, it's SBA in their list. If they're on the list, it's a phase one. We kind of talked about business expenses. If we are doing a refinance with business expenses coming out, the SBA also wants to see a detailed list of what the money's being used for. And we talked about the refinance program as far as showing that we have qualified debt and the transcripts of the history and the copies of the notes and everything that we have. Now, as far as appraisal, this is something that the third-party lender always, 99% of the time, orders. And the only thing that the SBA requires on an appraisal is that the SBA be named in the appraisal as an intended user. So if they say, GE Credit Union hired us to do this appraisal, which is fine, but it has to say that the U.S. Small Business Administration is able to use this to report, because if it doesn't name SBA as an intended user, SBA feels like you can't use it, and we're going to kick it back out. Used to be that we also had to have HCDC named as an intended user. You can do that if you want to. It's not necessary, but go ahead. So that we feel comfortable with it as well. Generally, appraisals are three ways of appraising property. SBA requires that at least two of the three appraisal methods be used. If you order an appraisal and you say, well, we just want the cost method and we don't care about the other two, SBA is not going to accept it. So they don't care which two you use, but they want just two of the three appraisal methods to use. Now, as far as valuation of the collateral versus the project cost, SBA is pretty much a liberal lender when it comes to that. They basically say that the appraisal, if we're doing a real estate, needs to come out at least 90% of the project cost. So if we have $1 million project cost, and we're buying land, and we're building a building, and we have professional fees, and the appraisal on $1 million project cost project only has to come in at $900,000. It doesn't even have to come into the project cost. So as long as it's 90% or more of the project cost, SBA will accept that valuation. If it comes in at less than 90%, then we have to start reducing our loan amounts and the borrower has to come in with additional equity to get our loan to value to that 90%. Now, the one case that that rule doesn't apply is in the case of a change of ownership. So if I'm an owner of a business and I'm selling my building to Casey, she's coming in and buying the business, and she's buying the building as part of the transaction, and it's a change of ownership, and Casey's going to finance the building purchase through a 504 loan, in that case, the SBA requires the appraisal value to be equal or greater to the purchase price of the building. And the reason they do that is because if the appraisal came in less than the purchase price, SBA would deem that gap to be goodwill, and we can't finance goodwill through the 504 program. So in a change of ownership, the appraisal has to be greater or more of the appraisal of the purchase price of the building property acquired. Now, if we're buying new equipment as part of the project, SBA will use the purchase price as the valuation of the equipment. But if we're buying used equipment, that equipment will have to be appraised as well. So we're always going to have appraisals on real estate. We sometimes will have appraisals on equipment, whether it's used or brand new. Now, there are fees involved in the 504 loan, and the easiest way is probably just to break out kind of an example project. So here we have a $1 million project, which is our traditional 50, 40, 10 for $1 million. Now, as far as the third party, let's look at the SBA first. So for the SBA loan, an interim lender is going to make a loan for $400,000. I'll back up a little bit. We're having a session tomorrow kind of on closings and funding 504 loans, but it is, as I haven't really said, 504 is takeout financing. So when the SBA loan is approved, we don't come in with a check right away. We wait until the project is completed until we fund the loan. So the third-party lender generally would commit to doing both a permanent 50% loan and then an interim 40% loan. And so during the purchase or renovation or construction, the third-party lender is going to be out with 90%, basically holding, which we prefer would be two different notes, a permanent note for 50% and an interim note for 40%. So the 40%, the net debenture, is what the interim lender is going to finance through that interim loan. That's what's going to be, that money is going to be used in the project to do what we're doing, and that money is going to be paid off by the SBA funding down the road. Now, as far as HCDC and the SBA, there are certain costs involved in the program, which are then rolled into my end loan, my end 504 loan. Our loans are pooled. When we fund a loan, our loans are closed as a dry closing, so a borrower would come in and sign all the paperwork, and then we submit the loans to the SBA, where they're pooled on a monthly bond sale with the loans from CDCs all over the country. At any given month, this pool of loans could be anywhere from $350 to $500 million. And the way we get our money then is this pool picks up a 100% guarantee from the SBA. The pool then with this guarantee is then sold to private investors who purchase these loans because they get a better interest rate than if they just went and bought treasury bonds. They're as safe as treasury bonds, but they pay a higher interest rate And so that's why there's a market for buying these. So private investors come in and they buy the pool, and then from the pool, the sale every month, the money's wired back to these third-party lenders all over the country to pay off these interim loans. Now, there's two fees which are involved in the sale of the bonds. There's a fiscal agent fee, and then there's an underwriting fee. And the fiscal agent is the agent that works on behalf of the SBA on a monthly basis to negotiate the interest rate on behalf of the industry. And then the underwriters are the folks that are actually finding people that are wanting to buy the bonds. And so they get paid on that. And then HCDC, for its work in getting the loan approved, gets a processing fee. Our processing fee is generally 1.5% of the net debenture. So between the fiscal agent fee, the processing fee, and the underwriting fee, those costs, and then we can also include HCDC closing costs for our to cover our closing, our attorney fee, our title insurance, our recording fees can also be rolled in to the sale, and that we end up with a loan, in this example, of $415,000, of which $400,000 goes and pays off the interim loan, and the remainder pays the various costs, and then there's a balance that goes back to the borrower of $692. Now, if a borrower wanted to, they could pay the closing costs and they can pay the processing fee out of pocket and not finance it. But SBA requires that the fiscal agent fee and the underwriting fee be added to the net debenture and sold as part of the gross debenture. Now, I don't think one time in all the years I've been doing this would ever anybody come in and pay those fees out of pocket. They generally, everybody wants to finance as much as they can. But that's kind of how my end loan is determined, if the fees involved and where the money goes. Now the only, as I said, this is pretty easy for a bank because there's really not an SBA involvement to their loan. However, the SBA, in order to fund the program, because it's not funded by any taxpayer dollars, it's funded by fees generated out of the program, does charge the third-party lender a one-time fee for participating in the 504 loan. They feel like the bank or the credit union or the investor has got a 50% involvement in the first mortgage on a piece of collateral. They're pretty secure. And forgetting that, the SBA charges a one-time fee of 0.5% of the third-party lender loan amount. So, example before, if the third-party lender loan is $500,000, 0.5% would be charged to the bank to go to the SBA. Now, honestly, most banks don't pay that out of their own pockets. They charge it to the borrower, which is fine. But if you're building in a fee structure for your loan and you're doing a 504, you need to understand that there's going to be a 0.5% that you need to collect someplace that's going to be going to the SBA. Now, if we're in a shared position, there's no fee, nobody ever does that. I haven't had one deal that we've ever done where the bank said, we'll give the SBA a shared lien position on the collateral because we don't want to pay $2,500. So, now as far as how the submission process works, as I said earlier, ACDC is a nonprofit that has a membership and a board, and from the membership and board, we have numerous committees, including three project review committees. Here in Cincinnati, we have a project review committee that's made up of business people, bankers, accountants, some government folks that meet a couple times a week, usually at 3:30 on a Thursday afternoon, and they're the ones that get the initial review of loans. Bill Haggerty, who's back in the room, is one of our members, has been for a long time. And it's a real good group that gets together. They take their work very seriously to make sure that what we're submitting to the SBA is hopefully a good loan. To get to the loan committee, we generally need an application probably at least a week or maybe a week and a half to 2 weeks prior to the meeting date in order to give us enough time to do the underwriting we need to do to get our credit memos done and everything ready to submit to the loan committee for their approval. We also have a second loan committee in Kentucky that meets once a month, and we've been having much activity in Kentucky. And then lastly, within the last year, we took over a CDC in Canton, Ohio. So we have a loan officer in Canton, and there is a project review committee that meets, that handles loans in the northeast part of Ohio for that territory. Once the loan is approved by the credit committee, we then can give the approval to submit to the SBA. And so a lot of the stuff that we talked about earlier as far as the forms and the tax returns and the project cost and the eligibility terminations, we have to have all that put together to submit to the SBA. And the SBA has a centralized processing center in Sacramento, California, which if everything goes well, they can give us an approval probably for the week. It can be a pretty quick process. You know, unfortunately, it's also totally in writing. They don't talk to us, we don't talk to them. So everything we send them has to be either a credit memo or a written form. And if they have questions, then they email us back with questions, and it goes back and forth and back and forth. But if we give them everything that they want, and they understand the loan, and they understand the credit, and it's eligible, we can generally get an approval within 5 working days, maybe even quicker than that. It can be pretty quick. SBA is going to basically give us 3 approvals. They're going to give us a credit approval, which is basically the loan authorization. This is the formal document committing SBA to the financing, subject to certain terms and conditions. That loan authorization approval is good for 4 years. So once the SBA approves a loan, we have up to 48 months in order to get it closed and funded. So for some large projects, it could be a large hotel project or big manufacturing, you could be looking at doing an construction project that could be 18 months to 2 years before it's done, and then we have to get, so we have 4 years in order to be able to, for the approval to stay in place. It's a little different for the refinance program. The refinance approval is good for 6 months, because the idea is with a refinance, all we're doing is as soon as we're approving it, we're going in and we're refinancing the debt, so we should be closing right away. So the SBA only gives us 6 months on a refinance deal. The SBA is also going to give us and the third party lender an approval on the appraisal. And so they're going to review the appraisal, and if it's acceptable, they'll give us a docket, an email that says it's approved, and then the same thing for the environmental. So for a third-party lender wanting to know that the SBA has approved everything, you're going to get a loan authorization, you're going to get approval for the appraisal, and approval for the environmental. And once you get all 3 of those, you know we're good to go. Now that the loan authorization process then is now approved. Now tomorrow, we're going to have a second workshop with Tom Ruckenberg, who's a partner at Wood & Lamping, who's our primary closing attorney, who's going to be talking about after the approval process, the closing process, what do we need to get closed, and the funding process, and like that. So I'm kind of done now, because now we've gone through the whole thing, we've gotten the loan approved, and if you want to get to the second stage, you're more than happy to free to come tomorrow and get the closing workshop. Yes.
I got a couple questions about your fees. You showed a $1,000 increment to the administrator of the SBA.
The fiscal agent?
Fiscal agent, right. Is that a set fee of $1,000 per loan, or is that a percentage?
It's a percentage. So again, this is an example.
So it's 1/4 of 1%.
Yes.
Okay. And your loan, yours is 1.5%, the underwriting fee, is that, how do you determine that?
That is a, again, that's a, percentage of the net debenture? And I don't have that right in my head exactly what that percentage is.
It's not down to 16, 38, or something like that.
But obviously, as the loans get bigger, those fees get bigger. If the loans were smaller, if we were doing a $100,000 loan, those fees would be smaller.
And do you always round up to the years 15?
But they always round up to the year 1,000 because the debentures are sold on $1,000 increments.
Thank you.
Yes?
On a construction loan, is the 504 loan funded from you in 50, 40 increments with every draw?
No, so again, so now we have the approval, everything really goes back to the third-party lender. The third-party lender then acts as the initial funder of whatever the project is, which could be just funding the purchase of a building, and we're done, or it could be funding the purchase of land, or funding the construction or renovation. So the third-party lender, again, in this example of a $1 million project, is going to fund $900,000, and the borrower is going to bring in $100,000 to cover our $1 million cost. So money is just spent until $1 million is out and the project's done, and then when it's completed and everything's done the way we told the SBA it's supposed to be, then we close our $400,000 loan and pay off that interim loan. So it doesn't have to be divvied up in any particular fashion.
So in a construction project, 40% isn't coming until the construction is completed?
Right, so we do not fund until everything is done. That is why the third-party lender generally would have a bridge loan, an interim loan, during the construction phase or the closing phase, because we don't fund until everything's done, which could be 30 days or it could be 3 years.
Is the project reappraised at the end?
No.
Okay, so there could be structural issues and nobody would be the wiser?
What we do, though, is we do get a statement from the appraiser or a construction manager or the construction company that the building was built or the renovations were done according to the plans and specs that were submitted to the SBA, but it's not reappraised at the time. The other thing about the program is because our funding does not come out until the end, our interest rate is not determined until the end. And so, not to take away from what Tom's going to talk about tomorrow, but when we close a loan, we submit our paperwork to the SBA where it's pooled with these loans from around the country. And at that time, the fiscal agent and the underwriters work together to price the loan in order to sell on the secondary market, sell in the market. Today, our all-in rate is probably a little under 5%. But that is not determined until that borrower actually funds. And so we could have had somebody that got approved last month that won't know what their interest rate is until the project is done. And if it's a big construction project, their interest rate may not be determined for another year, for a year and a half. And so there is an interest rate risk, both up and down, depending on what happens in the future, to what the end interest rate our borrower gets. What we're basically saying is, we're committing to loan you money at a fixed interest rate for 20 years, but we don't tell you what that interest rate is until the bonds actually sell, because we don't know. Now, we're tied to the 10-year treasuries, and the 10-year treasuries for years have been pretty low, and they haven't moved very much. We've been saying interest rates are going to go up for years, and they haven't done it, but there is that risk. It's also the other side. You know, if rates were higher, rates could also drop over time, too.
Is there kind of a rule of thumb when you look at 10-year treasuries and that point or closer?
Yeah, no, I did if you get our monthly newsletter, we did an article in the newsletter that just came out that was specifically how the interest rates are determined.
So,
why are the loans? Mm-hmm. The loan would be collectively sold to be invested in the treasury.
Well,
and what's the purpose?
Well, the purpose, so it's a way of funding the loan. Back in the early 80s, when the Federal Financing Bank funded the loan, money was coming out of the government, and President Reagan said, we don't want to fund these loans anymore. And so this is a way to get private investors to pay for the loans. What they're getting is a 100% guaranteed guarantee from the SBA that's collateralized by real estate. So an investor could come in and buy a loan or a part of the pool, and they're getting an interest rate for 20 years fixed at a higher rate than they would get if they bought treasuries. Plus, they're guaranteed not to lose any principal because it's 100% guaranteed. So it's institutional investors looking for the best return, the safest return. This is an investment vehicle for them to put their money in and get a better return than just putting it in the bank. So that's the market.
Okay.
But it allows small businesses that would never be able to get a 20-year fixed rate loan from anybody to get at least a portion of the project funded and a 20-year fixed rate. So that's a lot to take in.
One more thing.
Yes?
Now, why is it called the debenture again?
It's just the name of the...
Just the name?
Just the name, yeah.
The debenture.
The debenture.
Okay.
Andy, we've got certificates of completion. You still need to sign them. Mm-hmm. Why don't we give you a round of applause for...
Talking for...